something I've been dreaming of my whole life. And interestingly enough, almost exactly a year ago today, on my mother's birthday, which was January 10th, when she turned 91, I took a trip to New Zealand, which was also a lifetime dream. And I really think that we sometimes put on the back burner adventure, right? Our life happens, and we have children, and our work, and our loves, and our families, and our friends, and our passions. Many times we forget where we fit in to that equation. And when my husband passed away 2.5 years ago, we've been together since I was a teenager, 41 years. And so imagining life, all my adventures and my dreams had been tied up with him as my best friend, my partner, the father of my children. And all of a sudden, I found myself in a situation where I was reinventing myself.
Alex,
you know?
Excuse me one second. You're not being filmed yet.
Oh.
So just could you bring us up?
Okay.
You need to film her?
I'm working.
It's working?
I'm working.
Technical.
Take two. Can you hear me all right without the microphone?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to begin again. I'm just going to say that we have the opportunity in our life to include adventure in it, right? We have our work, we have the things that we do every day. And one of the things that happened when my husband passed away 2.5 years ago is that I looked around, and don't get me wrong, I don't mean this as a complaint in any way. I've had a rich, full, adventurous life. But I realized how small I had allowed myself to become. And when I was packing up our house to move in with my friend, I realized that, like my altar table by the side of my bed with my crystals and my tarot cards and all of that, was sort of really the only tiny little piece of the authentic me that was there. And so I started thinking about, how do we cross this bridge? I had been a primary breadwinner in my family. I earned most of the money. Not that there weren't times where we didn't switch across the years, but in the later years, I was mostly the one that was supporting my family. So the financial part of it was not as devastating to me as the aspect of being alone. And not that anybody's really ever alone. We have our, you know, our soul family and our real family and our friends, but I had to begin to think about the things that I wanted. What were my dreams? And they needed to be reinvented. And you know, many times I think in our lives, we forget to dream, or we forget that the dreams we've had that we complete, we don't complete them. And what I think about is when you read a good book, right, that you just, you know, you can't get enough of it. You're just reading and reading and reading, and you get to the last page of the book, and you close the book, and you're finished. Are you angry at the book? No. Do you maybe hope that the author that wrote this book will write another book that you can sail through and enjoy again? Yes. But I think in life that we forget to be complete with things. And many of us have worked really hard on ourselves. We've done, you know, meditations, and we've done practices, spiritual practices, and we love the people that we love. And we forget about loving ourselves and being complete with ourselves. So one of the things that I have learned is to make sure, and you can do it as a ritual too, of being complete with things. So that we can, unless we're complete, you know, the to-do list that Janet talked about the other day, is we're never done. If we don't check it off and be complete, there's always more to do than you get done. And so one of the things that I would suggest, and we're going to have a little fun, if you don't mind, in a few minutes, because we've been sitting a lot and listening a lot. I love all the woo-woo metaphysical stuff, okay? I love my bowls and my bells and my crystals and my essential oils.
but I also really love science. And people think that science, they forget that science is an art. It is not just facts and symbols, it's actually an art. And so what I love to do is create a bridge between science and between art. And so one of the things that there's been a lot of research on, and just indulge me a little bit here, is that there's been a lot of research done on the impact of sound on water. And I'm a sound healer, so I work a lot with sound and my voice and singing and art. And there's something to be said where the impact of sound on water, if you play really discordant music, the crystals in the water are actually like disjointed and they're like all broken up. And when you play something soothing and loving, they're actually, they form these beautiful crystal formations. Well, guess what? We are over 78% water. So the same impact that sound has on water, it has on us. And one of the really true gifts is that you retain the sound on a cellular level. Because what I have found is even when we do completion ceremonies, when we feel like we're done with all the little dangly things, you ever wake up in the middle of the night and all of a sudden you just like fold upright out of bed and you can't sleep for some reason? It could be excitement. Like when I was getting ready to come to India, I woke up and it was like, I was like, my heart was racing, and it wasn't fear. There was a little bit of fear. I was traveling across the world to a place I'd never been before, but there was also the excitement. Sometimes also, we may have something that's going on in our life or our body with our health, and we have these moments that are like panicking. So you can use sound to calm yourself, because what I have found is that chaos will absolutely come into your life. We have no control about when it comes, how it comes, the form that it takes, how long it'll stay with us, and when it will leave. However, we do have a choice about how we respond to it. And so if you can bear with me, there's something in science. Have you ever, you've heard of the number pi, right? Pi goes infinitely. Like when you drop a pebble in the water and the ripples go out endlessly, right? And so there's something in science that corresponds to the number pi, and it's called the Fibonacci code. And the Fibonacci code is said to be the seed of life. And it is a ratio of masculine and feminine energies. And we all have both masculine and feminine energies in ourselves. And it's a ratio of 8 feminine to 5 masculine. And to give you an example, it's said to be the seed of life or the seed of creation. If you were out walking in the forest and you picked up a pine cone at the intersection of 8 and 5, that's where pine seeds are born. And so I'd like to invite you, if you would, to come standing up for a minute, move your chairs back, and come out and stand. We're going to recreate the Fibonacci code for ourselves, all right? And you're going to need a little room. I'm going to do the counting, and I'm going to show you what we're going to do. Have any of you seen the movie The Wizard of Oz? Okay, you know Glinda the Good Witch? She inspires me because she comes floating in this beautiful rainbow bubble. I love blowing bubbles. I'm an old lady, but I still love blowing bubbles. And you know how when you blow bubbles, there's these beautiful rainbow swirls in them? So I'm going to show you in a minute a motion. But while we're doing the motion, I'd like you to imagine creating this beautiful rainbow bubble all around you, above and below, okay? And what we're going to do is we're going to recreate the Fibonacci code for ourselves, and we're going to do it in a rainbow bubble. Because what I love about Glinda is she comes floating in this beautiful, like these beautiful Indian women that I see in front of me, like just magically gorgeous, and this rainbow bubble, and she comes floating into all this crazy chaos, right? I mean, the Wicked Witch of the West, she's throwing firebolts, the Scarecrow's on fire, the little munchkins are running for cover in the flowers, and Glenda comes floating in this beautiful rainbow bubble. So because we know that chaos will come into our life, how about if we create a little bit of whimsy and we create for ourselves a beautiful rainbow bubble that we can float amidst the chaos that may come in when we're adventuring and when we're living our life, all right? So what we're gonna do, and don't worry, I'll do the counting when we do it. Remember, we're gonna be imagining a rainbow bubble all around. We're gonna start with our hands in prayer pose at the heart center. And we're gonna go up and out, shooting white light out of our fingers and around and down and back to the heart. And we're gonna do that for 8 rotations. And like I said, I'll do the counting. And on the last one, I'll say, this is the last time in this direction. And then we'll reverse for 5. And we'll go down and out, shooting the white light out of our fingers and around and up and back to the heart. Okay, you can do this eyes open or closed. So we have our hands in heart center in prayer pose, and we go up and out, shooting the white light out of our fingers and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart, and up and out and around and down and back to the heart. This is the last in this direction, up and out and around and down and back to the heart. And now we reverse and we go down and out, shooting the white light out of our fingers and around and up and back to the heart, and down and out and around, up, and back to the heart, and down, and out, and around, and up, and back to the heart, and down, and out, and around, and up, and back to the heart, and the last one, down, and out, and around, and up, and back to the heart. So this is a gift. You've just created a beautiful Glenda-like rainbow bubble. And so wherever you are in your life, whether you're working, sometimes there's those days when we're working and everybody's going crazy and there's all kinds of noise, right? That wah, 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 wah. And we start feeling anxious or, you know, just really, whether it could be something wonderful that's going to happen, but it starts that kind of what I call monkey mind. Right, we start going up here and trying to think about all the ways that we can sabotage ourselves. So if that happens to you, stop for a minute. Put your palms together. Rub them like this, like you're making an old-fashioned campfire with a stick. And when you've got some nice heat going in your hands, cup your hands over your nose and mouth and inhale deeply, imagining your favorite aroma. Whether it's the scent of a rose or a piece of sandalwood or the smell of the rain before it falls, and just inhale that and call in that rainbow bubble so that you can just very effortlessly float amidst the chaos that comes our way in life and work and on adventure. And it can bring you a little bit of peace in a very short period of time. The thing I like about it, I usually, when I do my sound healing, I've got chakra bowls and drums and bells and all kinds of things. Well, I can't bring those with me everywhere I go. And many of us have wonderful tools that we use in our life, right? For healing, for cooking, for being alive and doing what we do. And yet, all you need, as far as I know, as long as you're alive, you're breathing. Right? So your breath is in fact a meditation. Your heart is beating. And if you tune into that inner drum, heartbeat, with your breath and your heart and your rainbow bubble, you can float amidst the chaos, just like Glenda. Because chaos absolutely will happen. It will come in. And so what I would say to you is, if this is something, for whatever reason, that doesn't resonate with you, choose something, whether it's a bubble or a bowl or whatever it is, and just remember 8 to 5, 8 feminine, 5 masculine, and float amidst the chaos of your adventures and your work in your beautiful rainbow bubble. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And you know, I've been a singer my whole life. My sister Robin can tell you that from the age of 3, I'd pick up a microphone and sing anywhere in front of anyone. And I was a professional singer for many years. And then for the last 20 years, I've been in finance. And what I'm finding is, I didn't realize that the energy of money was something that I had I didn't like it. I had preconceived notions, like money was the root of all evil and things like that, or that healing wasn't something that you could charge money for. And then I realized that it's an energy exchange. And I began to see how I could bridge my life in the financial world to my life in the spiritual world, because I've been meditating since I was 11, so I've been meditating for 50 years. And singing all that time. And so what I'm on, my great adventure right now is, if you think of a bridge, right? I started over here in the financial world and I started doing my sound healing, and I got to the top of the bridge and I thought, I'm kind of done with the financial stuff. I love being people, I work with the elderly in the United States, and they call me their money angel, right? I find a way to help them have money when they're older in their retirement. And then this sound healing, the vibration that elevates people and brings them to a place of stillness in themselves. And I started to imagine how I could maybe, instead of having 80% of my income and my resources be from financial planning and things like that, to having it switch and be 20% on the financials. I'm not saying I'm walking away from it. And then the other is the spiritual sound healing work. And so now, it's been a process. It's over the course of time, I'm really close to launching my new adventure, which is bringing in the sound healing and the humanitarian work into the financial. And I recently switched jobs from a corporation. It's still doing, it's called Reverse Mortgages for the Elderly. And I'm still working for a corporation, but it turned out that the corporation that I work for has human trafficking as, you know, putting an end to human trafficking as one of their nonprofit initiatives. And so I'm weaving this new fabric between, and weaving a new adventure between the financial and the spiritual. And it's a beautiful journey. And I encourage any of you who feel trapped in one or just longing to do the other to go ahead and give it a try. It's very, very rewarding.
Mm-hmm.